Yance Ford.
Thank you. Thank you guys for sticking around. I am going to introduce and ask the following people who have been in the film and who have helped make the film possible to join me on stage for the Q&A. I think it is appropriate to start out with our executive producer, Mr. Danny Glover, if you would come on up. And our producer, Justin Barnes, also joining me on stage. And then, thank you. I'm so glad that Harvey Walker is here. Harvey, would you come up and join us on stage, please? Kevin Myers is also here. Kevin, would you come up and join us on stage? Our director of photography, Alan Jacobson, is here. Alan, come on down. You're the next contestant. Our composer, our co-composer, Craig Sutherland, are you in the house? Scotsman. Yes, there he is. I knew you were there. Have a seat, gentlemen, have a seat.
Yancy, I wanted to know if we could just start by asking all the folks on stage here to just talk a little bit about their involvement and how they first got associated with the film and what their roles were. So, Can I start with Jocelyn or start with Danny? Which would you prefer?
Why don't we ping pong and start with Danny and just jump around.
You want to start with me?
Yes, yeah. Sir.
Oh, I was the first one called up here. I can't go on and think about how this came to us had it not been for Jocelyn Barnes. We formed Louverture Films almost 14 years ago to do the kind of filmmaking to present to the audience the lives, the stories of, and history as well, of those whose lives is stories are often passed or thrown into the waistbands of history. And I was just there at this restaurant this morning with my grandson, where Yance and I sat and talked about what I had seen. And for so much of that, in terms of contextualizing this story, the vision of it is not simply Yancey's story, but it is deeply woven in the American story of African Americans, the history here. And once I began to think of, even though I'm a generation older, once I began to think of William being me, all of the things, my family being Yancey's family, my mother and father with their enormous aspirations, who had come, my mother from the South as well, and making that my story, as I think the audiences begin to embrace that, the audiences, it made it so much powerful for me in understanding it and made the journey remarkable as well. Because every time I've seen it, and I've seen the film no less than, in public, no less than five times, and everything I've captured something else in here which resonates as powerful today as it did when it happened 24 years ago, or when I first saw it.
That's amazing. You know, before I make this really terrible mistake, I'm going to actually correct it. I wouldn't be up here without Danny, without Jocelyn, without the involvement of all these people. But I wouldn't be standing or breathing without someone who I don't get to thank often in public. And since there are so many family and friends here tonight, I just want to ask Amanda to stand and to give her a round of applause. Woo! Because I think that every filmmaker who does something like this knows the feeling of being awake in the middle of the night and staring up at the ceiling and not knowing how they're going to continue, or being racked with doubt and guilt and, you know, anxiety about money and if it's good enough for the people that you're working with. And Amanda has been that person for me for the last 21 years, and this film would not be possible, and I would not be here without her. So thank you, my love. And with that, maybe we should go to Alan and how you got involved in this project. Someone else who has a partner who's been doing the same thing.
Yeah, my wife Karen, who's here tonight too.
Karen Rosen.
And quite a journey. Yancey first came to me and gave me an incredible gift as a cinematographer, invited me into this incredible story with the trust to try to photograph the unphotographable. We didn't talk much about what the picture would look like, but we wanted to talk a lot about what it would feel like, and we tried to bring that to the visual design of the film and give a sense of an emotional experience for the audience. So it was a tremendous gift, and it's been a great joy of my life.
Now,
and to
Kevin,
be here with these gentlemen,
well,
tremendous joy.
Kevin and Harvey, I know that this is the first time you're seeing the film tonight. I don't want to put you on the spot too much, but I'm wondering if you can share some of your feelings.
Tonight was tough. Yancey and the rest of the crew, I mean, a really fabulous job. I had no idea what it would look like or how things would turn out. And I'm just happy that the story is being told. It's told correctly. And that, you know, William is smiling down on you, and you can find some peace, some comfort in that, you know, the story's out there and it'll always be, it'll never be forgotten.
I just want to say that it was a wonderful job, everyone. I think it was bittersweet, and it, I think it brought closure to a lot of things. Seeing William again, seeing Mrs. Ford again, even seeing Mr. Ford, it took me right back and to when I was still in Central Iceland, when life was a little simpler and then it became complicated, you know, with William's death. Wonderful job, and I can't wait to see it again and run and tell everybody.
I spoke about it. It felt like when I saw the film, it was a conversation in the first person. And it's like these brothers right here were people, brothers that I grew up with, you know. And all of this, I mean, we talk about generations, the generational shift and everything else, but it's still the same. It doesn't change. The dynamics doesn't change, you know. And that's the question for us, the intimacy in this story. It's not, you know, anything sometimes as intimate as that, that allows you to search back in your own mind and remember those moments, you know, and remember those and how, whatever way in which you navigated something because you were too big or too dangerous or too suspect, you had all the characteristics, or too black, all of those things that you you navigate in some sort of bypass in those things. You don't end up talking about that often, an opportunity to talk about that within the context of my life, you know, because it seems so, it's even though I feel as if I escaped to some degree and never felt any different than that, that it wasn't that I was smarter than or whatever the circumstances, but I know the story and feel the story. And when I think about my grandson, who I just had, his 13th year, I don't want him to repeat. I don't want the same story. I want to have him with a different story. And perhaps that's why we want to do this kind of work, or do the kind of work that I've done. I have my friend Sophia Elijah, who's a great lawyer, and with the Alliance of Families for Justice. And it deals with families, interesting, who of men who are incarcerated, you know, men who've been left and pushed aside in terms of history. And so you sit with it and you say, what do we have to do? What is the work that we have to do? What are the issues that we have to do with race? What do we have to do with gender? What are the issues we have to do? How can we find that kind of real honesty, that kind of real dangerous spot that we have in the conversation we need to have, you know, mm-hmm. we need to have. Mm-hmm. And it's not that our parents and they ran away from it. They were searching for something else. They were searching in the belief that there was something else in that sense.
Jocelyn, can you talk a little bit about how you first came onto this project, which was a couple years into the project, I believe, is that right?
Yeah, I came into the project. I mean, Yancey's been making this film for 8 years, really, maybe a bit longer than that, but about 8 years. And I came into the project as an executive producer to help with the financing, because I knew that you were starting to get into some trouble with it. And over the course of a few years of conversations and looking at cuts and so forth, Yancey asked me to come in and take over the production. Really, I think to free you from all of the encumbrances of physical production and financing and all that kind of stuff, but also as a creative partner with Yancey and the team, with Alan and eventually Craig. And we had this strange insight at one point that there was something Danish about Yancey's film. we decided to move the edit from the United States to Copenhagen, Denmark. Partly because it seemed as if every week there was another killing and another white person who was not going to be prosecuted for the killing, or a cop who was not going to be prosecuted. And the intimacy of violence through this kind of petty apartheid system that we have here in the US, where people were dealing with stop and frisk and all of this kind of stuff constantly happening, I think was taking a tremendous toll on you emotionally. And getting out of the country, not that it's necessarily better in other countries, but getting out of this country was important at that point. And so we had the great good fortune of working with Janus Billeskov Jensen, who's a tremendously gifted editor and who happened to be free in this short window. We just pounced him, really. And the co-producer on the film, Sina Sorensen, who's a wonderful, wonderful producer and has been a really great producing partner with Louverture. We've done a number of films together now. So we had, we moved the edit to Copenhagen, and that was a very good decision. It was very intense and tough to move to another country with a film like this. And we spent 9 months there, and I spent probably about 4 months of that 9 months there in the edit, and then came back and did the post here, and worked with Craig and Hildur and an incredible post team.
I just wanted to let Craig say a few words before we take some questions from the audience.
I mean, normally a question and answer session, I like to talk about how the music was done and things like that, but tonight I think it's important that we recognize that you're home. You've came home, you brought the film home. You know, I don't really know what to say other than that Yance knew what he wanted for this movie, and I just allowed myself to be open to the whole thing. And I can only say thank you for bringing this Scotsman over to America and giving me a lesson, you know. It's very important, this movie, and I can only thank you for letting me come in and do what I did.
Thank you, man.
This is the kind of film that people, they thank you for letting you work on the film. This is the kind of film that this is. And that's a testament to Yancey, but to all these great people out here.
They don't always thank you. on shoot days when we're moving into our 14th hour and I go out to get food and I come back with beer and candy corn, and that actually happened. I fed Alan beer and candy corn one day because I was just completely burnt out. We were, you know, what's not in the cut is what we also shot. You know, after my mom passed away, we shot, you know, cleaning at her house. And, you know, every single stage, and which is where I also discovered hundreds more photographs. So, you know, we had done one round of shooting of photographs and then found an entire, we found the young, the story of my parents as youngsters in that second trove of photographs. So, you know, the things that really helped the story be universal, we discovered after Barbara's passing. And that one day when the junk luggers were coming to take the furniture and the donations, and I was just sort of walking around the house thinking, how did we wind up here? And I'm, you know, trying to make myself useful, just went and got candy corn and beer at 11 o'clock in the morning. I think there were lots of alarmed text messages exchanged that day. But yeah, you know, I have been, I was, when we were at the opening, and I think this is maybe a good way to transition into questions. You know, one of the questions that the Film Society asked me was how I was feeling, you know, about the film and what I hoped for the film. And, you know, I responded to that question by saying that I, you know, that on that evening I was thinking about Michael Brown's parents, right? Because it was earlier in that day where the deposition transcript from the civil suit that Michael Brown's parents filed against Darren Wilson, former police officer Darren Wilson, and the police department of Ferguson, Missouri. And in the transcript of that deposition, we learned that Darren Wilson had completely fabricated every single aspect of his encounter with Michael Brown. And it made me think of how the experiences too often, I mean, of how whiteness gets to be the authority of both lies and truth. And when you read in the transcript that Michael Brown's body was the weapon, it really concretizes the way in which it is almost impossible to understand what it means to your for your corporeal self to be weaponized. And that's what happened to William, right? The coroner describes him as 5'8" tall and obese. And you would think, by listening to the detectives and the number of times that they ask about how he works out and the number of times that they call him, you know, big guy, he was intimidating, you would think he was a giant. But the coroner, you know, he's short and fat. You know, so that's what's very much on my mind every time I see this film, and every time someone says it's so timely. It's like it's always been timely. And I just am glad that, you know, we've had the opportunity to put this together, and I'm really curious, I guess, now for questions from the audience. Yeah.
We'd love to take some questions. If you have any, please raise your hand. I know someone has. Yes. Julia, hello.
Sure. This is the first time that the film is playing in New York. And yesterday I got a call from someone on Long Island who Kevin actually saw a spot on the local news about the film. And there was a short article in the local newspaper, which is the largest newspaper on Long Island, about the film as well. So I can't know yet, because I'm assuming that over the next couple of days and weeks, that someone somewhere will hear about it and tell him. But my safety, I'm not too concerned about my safety right now.
Can I just add to that that I feel like the film really reveals how dangerous it is not to talk about these things. And that I think you, in many conversations about the physical safety and other issues connected with this film, that there was a conversation about the extent to which it was more dangerous not to talk about things than to talk about things.
Any other questions? Yes, sir.
Raise your hand if you know what a cesspool of corruption Suffolk County is. So I have lots of, pretty solid theories about who the phone calls were from. And it's not so important to me to name those people, because I think that, they deserve to, remain unnamed. I think that the point, though, is that they were able to reach out and try to intimidate my family without fear of repercussions. And they suffered no repercussions. And that's the point of including the phone calls. Because that happens all the time, not just with my family, right? Not just with my family, with all families. Whether it's, manifested in people wearing bracelets, with the name of the person who's murdered your child written on it, or other types of, things that say, I had a right to do this to you, I had a right to take this life. That's what those phone calls are about. The way I saw my life outside the film. Wow, I don't. Amanda, was there a life outside the film? It was pretty all encompassing. Raymond, I'm glad that you made that point. There are a few different what we call nows in the film. All right, there's the now of me in that sort of black void, when I'm in in this introspective moment trying to answer questions that I didn't know the questions beforehand. So there's that now, then there's the now of trying to discover who William was and learn more about him when I'm, with his journals, and then there's the now of talking to, Barbara and Lauren, and Kevin and Harvey, and then there's the now of asking questions, of the detective and the DAs. So it really is meant to sort of, in my mind, to it works as a way of detaching my character from time and allowing my character to sort of ping pong around in different places and function in different ways, but still, sort of be with the rest of the narrative and with the rest of the characters wherever they happen to be. But there was very little daylight between my life and the film for a very long time. Do I still feel this? I'm typically not a person who shares
And I totally blew it when I set up, you know, these interviews where I couldn't see anybody. I mean, literally, to answer some of the questions that were asked of me, we had to construct a wall of sound blankets. And the only two things that I could see were the lenses of the cameras and the marks. And I think that one of the things that I've taken away from that experience is that it's not as risky as it feels. But it took, you know, an extreme example to prove that to myself. Would you call it a diary format?
I wouldn't necessarily call it a diary format, but I think you said at one point that you wanted to be to honor the honesty and the courage of the people that were in the film, including two of the people who are in the film with us tonight, Kevin and Harvey, and your mom and Lauren, by being as honest as you could be. And so therefore there was a process of interrogation that was set up where Yancey, like the other people who were interviewed in the film, didn't know what the questions were gonna be. And we tried really hard to not, you know, because this often happens with documentary where you try to fill in a gap that you need some more information. We tried very hard not to do that. We tried very hard to, you know, on the one hand, isolate you so that you could think in a more internal way that was visible, legibly visible to the audience, and at a close camera angle, which I'm sure you can speak more to. But there was a process where we didn't know what Yancey was going to say, and Yancey didn't know what we were going to ask. And that was very, very important to the integrity of the interviews. It was tough. I mean, you say that you think it was easier than you thought it would be, but I remember times when we really were worried you were going to collapse.
Yeah, I mean, I was hallucinating. I was seeing things. I mean, it was just terrible. But it was my obligation. You know, when I called Kevin out of the blue, no, actually, I sent Kevin a letter via FedEx because I was so afraid of his reaction to my reaching out to him. I couldn't bring myself to call him first. So I sent him this FedEx, and then there was, you know, the amount of time that passed, and I was, you know, like, you know, which I think, you know, understandably, Kevin had to absorb the fact that I had reached out to him. It was the first time in, you know, over 15 years. And, you know, the same with Harvey, even though it was a little bit easier with Harvey because Harvey's mom and my mom were terrific friends. And so it was a bit easier for me to reach out to Harvey, but Kevin and I hadn't seen or spoken to each other in years. And so it was it's an obligation as an artist and as a filmmaker to, you know, if you're going to be a character in your story, you can't have a cheat sheet. You know, you can't have the cliff notes to it. You have to put yourself in the same place. And thankfully, I have, you know, partners who were able to, you know, push me and deal with my irritation. And you know, some of the best moments in my interviews are from when I got really agitated, because I was being deliberately agitated. You know, but yeah.
Sir, did you have a question?
Yes.
The accident was in February. William went to check on it the first time in March. The second time he went to check on it was April 7th, and that was the night that he was killed. So it was there, I mean, I can't do the math. But it was there for about 2 months, and it wasn't his car, it was his girlfriend's car. But, you know, the second time he visited that auto body shop, he was killed. Anxious to ask.
I'm gonna let you ask all your questions, but I just wanna ask one quick question first, which is just, could you talk a little bit about how you got your mom to do the interview? How you got her, you know, that must have been a big thing, right? I mean, I'm projecting, but I'm just saying, I can imagine that that must have been one of the more difficult things to get your mom to do it, and actually to do the interviews with her as well.
You know, actually, it's might come as a surprise. It was completely the opposite. You know, before my father died, he said to me two things. I want you to help your mother, and I want you to help your mother. It took me a long time to figure out what that meant. Helping my mother meant giving her a way to tell the story of what happened to our family without a filter, without a censor. And when I asked her, every time she said yes. Whenever we went out to the house, can we stay? Can we come? Yes. She never said no to anything. And as you can see, I could have left my mother alone in the house with the camera rolling. And we would have come back with, you know, like hours of amazing, completely usable footage. You know, I mean, I was barely needed during those interviews. My mom really was tremendously happy that we were doing the film, and it was a great comfort to her as we started working on it to know that it was going to be told. So.
Yes.
I won't forget any of you. I promise. I'm sorry.
One of the things of the film that really resonated with me, and I'll take from this, is Lauren's part, where she says, "No one ever talked about it."
Yeah.
And I think that we all can take a part of that away from this, in that that really hit home, because. You know, as William's best friend, you get stuck in a place with a million things bouncing in your head of what you should, shouldn't do, fear. I mean, it took me a good month and a half, we talked about it, where I was in shock and didn't know I was in shock. Mm-hmm. And just, you know, for everyone else, I was at the gym one day and I was leaving. There was a young lady walking and she was, you know, and I stopped to talk to her and asked her for a date. And I was so excited about it. I just got in the car and I was racing to tell William. Mm-hmm. And I'm driving down Spur Drive and get to almost to 111. When I actually pulled the car over, I'm like, where the hell you go? Mm-hmm. That just was our relationship. And then through the years, guilt. I felt afraid. Your mom was like a second mom to me. And I felt afraid to even be in her presence. Was she angry with me? Your dad? I remember when it was time for you, your sweet 16, and your prom was coming up. And that drove me nuts. I'm like, William, tell me what to do. I'm like, I know she may be queer. But I know he wouldn't let anybody else take you to the prom but him or me. I'm like, what do I do? I don't know what to do. I didn't even know how to approach you with this. So you just go back in your cubby hole, and next thing you know, 5 years goes, and 6 years go, and 7 years, and every year you're like, I wonder what's happened. But you're kind of, again, afraid to open a wound or to talk about it. So I think that's something that we all could take away from. That was the most magnetic part of the film to me, was that that's what we do a lot in our community, is that we don't talk about things. And everybody finds their own way to deal with things. And your mom, one Sunday in church, pulls me to the side and she says, you just don't speak to me. And I'm like, ah. You know, I'm sitting there like, I say hi. You know, I keep it moving, you know. She started asking me questions, and I was just like, you've been holding on to that for that long, you wanted to ask me. But she was afraid to ask me, and I surely was afraid to answer. Because even when you reached out to me, I was like, what in the world? I think someone just asked about the people sitting outside and the repercussions of making a film. That question has been asked. and you know, we had other people that we wanted to talk to, that you're afraid to open that can of worms, you know, to see what might come out. So much time has passed. But again, you know, we have to learn to talk to each other, because it seems like, especially after watching the film, yourself and myself and your family, everybody was hurting, but no one had sense enough to reach out and say, I'm hurting.
How do I live with it?
I watch my back. You know, not knowing, not having ever seen the person who killed my brother, you know, is a bit disconcerting. But only in that most of the you know, acts of violence against Black people in my family and in other families across generations were perpetrated by unknown actors. You know, that's why the Klan wore hoods, so that they could be anonymous, right? So I live with, you know, the not knowing who Riley is, in the same way that those families lived with the Klan. You know, I have to tell you, I spend very little time thinking about him. That answer was very much in the moment. And it was honest when I answered it. And you know, I don't go out to the island as much as I used to. So there's a little bit of distance in that sense. But I think that it is, you know, Claudia Rankine, in that wonderful essay, The Condition of Black Life is Mourning, you know, it could just as easily have been called, you know, The Condition of Black Life is Anonymous, you know, Anonymous Murderers. You know, it's because I don't know who the nurse was or who the doctor was who let my grandfather suffocate in the colored waiting room, and I never will, and neither did my mother. She was 2 years old when he died. And I think that the point is not so much to identify individual actors as it is to identify the structures and the culture that makes their action allowable, permissible, you know, justifiable, and then you know, sort of sanctioned by the state, ultimately. If that answers your question.
You're welcome.
Yes.
Yeah.
My two cents on your question, I'm sure Harvey and everybody else here who's a parent, it is everybody. I teach my daughter, keep your opinion to yourself and be careful, because in all the incidents that we see nowadays, you walk out the door, you may not come back for the slightest comment. People are who they are nowadays. And there's an awful lot of people, you turn on the news every single day, that are getting killed for nothing. You know, a guy wants to jump in an ambulance and run over an EMT. Yeah. Like, how do you make sense of that? So you tend to look out the world and say, it could be anybody.
Yes, sir.
This is the direction that I was going in life. I have a very, you know, I think that the notion that that there's catharsis involved in this kind of work is really, I think it's really an illusion, and I think it's really perpetuated by folks who haven't suffered tragedy like this. There is no catharsis. There's only process and figuring out how to live with it on a day-to-day basis. And there's only the attempt to reckon with the life that you thought you were going to have versus the life that you have now because of this single action. You know, I had always and planned on being an artist, I did not think that my first project would be a film about my brother's murder. That just happens to be my situation. I hope that I've done him justice and done my family justice and opened up a conversation that needs to be had about why we are so afraid of black people. And the question at the end of the film, how do you measure the distance of reasonable fear? You know, it's not a rhetorical question. And one of the things that I find myself, you know, hearing sometimes is people talking about, you know, bravery and sadness and being moving, but skirting that last question. And that last question is perhaps the most important question in the film. Because if we don't start interrogating how our fear is formed, how our fear is justified, and then how our fear, sort of becomes law, we are never going to sort of break this cycle of I shot and killed so and so because I was afraid. Like you're entitled to your fear. You are not entitled to kill someone because you have some crazy fear. And I think that's what I hope the film will push people to think about.
I hope you don't mind, we have time for those last two questions here.
Yes, ma'am.
From concept to completion, it took 10 years.
Yes, ma'am.
No, my mother didn't fail. Our parents didn't fail. Our civil institution failed. Our civil institution is what failed. And it continues to, and it will continue to fail until there is a seismic shift in how we define justice in this country. You're welcome, Nicole. Hey, I laugh a lot. I know I don't come across as a person who laughs a lot.
Yeah.
You've known me for a very long time. I've had a sour puss for a long time. Indeed.
I'm afraid we have run out of time because it's midnight, but I hope that you will join us outside for a few moments if you have additional questions for Yancey and her team. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you.